There we go. We have a title for a message. Some people just got to have a title, right? It's called The Good Father. But you know, the reason it came about, the original title, which is what my title was, To My Two Sons. So, as far as God's concerned, as far as we're concerned, about you, but I'm starting to reflect about things a lot more. I start looking at things a little different and find myself just sitting around after I wake up from my nap, just thinking about stuff. So some of the things that have been on my mind are the next things that we're going to talk about. If you don't want to go to the next one. Again, these are my two sons. He's 6'3", and that's them. That was a picture taken at my mom's funeral. Next. But this is one of the things that's really been on my mind lately. You don't recognize what that is, then you got a problem. That's bacon, okay? So why have I been reflecting on bacon? Well, number one, I'm trying to remember, think through, should I start giving up bacon as I get older? You know, it starts to do stuff to you and really mess up your inside. So I've been reflecting, what should I do about bacon? And so at this particular time in my life, I have made no decision, but I will continue to eat it every time I get it for breakfast. Next one. Is anybody here that likes mosquitoes? we all hate mosquitoes, but what if mosquitoes, why can't mosquitoes suck the fat out of us instead of blood? Now, if they were sucking fat out of us, I could see a little use of mosquitoes, you know? I could have a couple mosquitoes around. You know, but at this point in my life, I can't find any use for mosquitoes and don't know why we're there. But you know, as I was talking about reflecting, I was thinking about my sons. You know, my mom passed about a year ago. And whenever you have a parent that passes, there is a time when you start doing a lot more reflecting. And I started thinking about some of the things that my mom had talked to me about and said to me. And I started wondering, what would I say to my sons? What would I really want my sons to know about me, about life, about the church, about everything that encompasses me? What would I want them to know? And I started thinking to myself, man, I would really want them to know how I thought about things, what God said about things, and how things are really viewed from God's perspective. So I said, you know, why don't I write this down for them to see, for them to know that if anything ever happens to me, man, they could say, here's what my dad thought, here's what my dad believed, and here's what I can hold on to in this life. Next slide. You know, let's just get real right away. Why should I follow God? I mean, you know, those are thoughts that go through all of our heads. You know, most of the time it happens during the times when we've been going through a lot of trouble, strife, loss, disoriented. When my mother passed, you start thinking through things when you go through hard times in life and say, man, why am I doing this? So I thought to myself, my sons might have that same question one day. Man, why am I doing this? What benefit am I getting out of being a disciple of Jesus Christ? What benefit would I have if I'm doing that, if you're visiting today? Man, why am I here at church today? Why should I study this Bible that you're telling me to study? Why should I even sit down with you, come over to your house? All seems a little kind of weird to me anyhow. But then you're trying to, you know, what is this all about? What's going on? Next slide. I don't know about you in your life, but is there anybody here, just by chance, that can relate to being lost? Can anybody relate to being confused? Anybody relate to being unsure and unclear and perplexed and disoriented and bewildered? Can anybody relate to that? You know, I can relate to those almost all the time, every day, going on with stuff going on in your life, because everything is always constantly being thrown at you from Satan and just naturally from life. I don't know about you, but this part of history, there's certain things that happen in the Bible that kind of gets you to question, okay, what's going on here? Now, this is a scripture. We're going to read it here in just a second, as soon as I put my glasses on. But I'm going to give you a little history before this happened. You know, this was, if you remember the story of Joseph, and if you remember that he was ended up being second in command only to Pharaoh in Egypt, then the generation came about, as the Bible describes, that knew not Joseph nor his God. So the Egyptians got scared with all these people here and said, you know what? We're going to enslave them and make it real hard labor on them. So they were in slavery, and they cried out for a deliverer. And then if you ever can stop back and think for a second, here your God in your mind has left you alone for generation after generation after generation after generation, so much so that you forgot about your God yourself almost, as a people. And then God says, okay, I'm going to deliver you. Brings the, okay, now we're going to have a deliverer. Great. We're going to be delivered. Okay, and now we're out here in the desert. We got delivered. Now we're out here in the desert. We're hungry. We're starving. So wait a minute. You brought us from slavery. You took us from our people anyway from the very beginning. Brought us here. We're in a foreign land. Now I'm hungry. I'm starving there. Don't you think there were some people that were there like, okay, what's going on here, God? What kind of God are you to do this to me? You know, and that's exactly what happened. Man, I want manna. I want water. We want this, like that. We had so many problems. Now, we like to think we'd be different. If I was there, I wouldn't be complaining. I'd be like, this is okay, great. No, no. You'd be complaining. And you'd be perplexed. What's God? And, you know, it's really funny. Here's what God says about himself. Right when he's talking to Moses, Moses has already gotten mad at the people, came down, they were in revelry, sin, going crazy. So he threw the tablets at them, blew them up, and then went back up the mountain. God said, you shouldn't have done that. We're going to do it again. Okay. But I want to tell you something. And as the Bible says, after he was chiseling away, Moses was chiseling away at these tablets. This is what God said about himself as he passed by. Then the Lord came down in a cloud and stood there with him and proclaimed the name, the Lord, as he passed in front of Moses, proclaiming. After all this bad history, he goes, the Lord, the compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness, maintaining love to thousands and forgiving wickedness, rebellion, and sin. You know, if you were in that crowd and you heard that, you go, oh, no. That doesn't sound like God. We just came out of so much strife, slavery. You know, we've been beat on, got ran out of town. Now we're in the desert and you ain't feeding us. This does not sound like you compassionate and you love me. But that's what God says about his character. Now, the people had a choice at that particular time. They could either believe this from the Lord, or they could believe the lie that Satan is telling them. That God is the God of slavery and abandonment, not the God of love, compassion, and forgiveness. You know, in our life, we have to be honest sometimes. We think that God is the God of abandonment. We think God is the God that leaves us alone to these issues in this life. But we forget that the whole reason why those things happened was not from God's decision versus man's sin. The slavery and all that stuff that happened to the Egyptians, the Israelites, happened because of the Egyptians' sin. Did not happen because of the Israelites' lack of faith. Didn't happen because God was mean. It's a product of the sinful heart. Some things we face in life, we blame on God. God had nothing to do with it. It's that we're facing the consequences, either of our own sin or someone else's sin. Now we have an opportunity as I speak to my sons, you're going to go through life, and there's certain things that you're going to try to blame on God that might be your fault, somebody else's fault, or Satan's intervention into your life to make those happen. But you have to make a choice, my son. You either believe God when he says who he says he is, or you believe the problems and the strife that you're facing right now. You know, and we as Christians, again, there's times that we go through some things. Hard things. And we're wondering, why are we going through this if you are this? But let's put this on hold for a second, and we'll come back. But let's go, God says he is all these things. I want to take you to another scripture that's one of my favorites. Let's go to 2 Timothy in your electronic device. 2 Timothy chapter 2. And verse 11. If you're a disciple, this scripture should encourage your heart. It says if we die with him, we will also live with him. So if we've been baptized for the right reasons and all the different things that need to happen at that time, repentance and understanding what's going on, then God says we will live with him. Number two, the second thing, he says if we endure, we will also reign with him. So let's stop there. What does endurance mean? It means to the end. Sometimes in the middle, it's nasty. That's when you want to quit. Your side's hurting. You're running. Oh, my gosh, my legs are turning into jelly. But, man, when you get done with that race, you fired up. You're wearing your little, hey, I completed the race. I'm good. I got done. Doesn't even matter the time. Took me 5 days, but I'm good. I made it. I endured. Nobody cares how long it took, as long as you got the medal. Man, as we endure as a Christian, sometimes we just think, oh, I'm just enduring, until you're just boom, flat out on the floor. I'm enduring this life for Jesus. Got it wrong. I'm enduring one day because I'm going to reign. Bible talks about I'm going to judge angels. Man, this life, Satan wants you to focus so much on what's going on right now. Man, we need to think about heaven as disciples. Amen. This is so much of a mist. It goes by like that. And if you're anywhere over 50 years old, you know that's the truth. Because somebody will say something to you and go, man, you know what? That was 20 years ago. Woo! What happened? Where did all that time go? I look at Connor and those guys, Cole, they're back there laughing. Yeah, man, you're going to be 50 one day. And it's going to come on you just like it came on me. What happened? And, as you think about that our life, if you consider our life an eternity, our life is like this. And eternity is like way over here. But we focus so much on what's going on right here. Man, gotta change our focus. So what I say to my sons when it's dark and it's down and you endure because you know one day you're going to reign. But God's still not done in this scripture. Let's go to the next one. If we disown him, he will disown us. Well, we might sit here and say, I've never disowned the Lord. Have you disowned his promises? Man, have you said, God, that's not true. You say that. You say you're this. I say you're not because of the situation that I'm in. Have you said to yourself that God who says, which this is awesome, let's look at the next scripture. It says, if we are faithless, In other words, if you got to a point in your life where there's a situation where you feel like nothing could overcome or change it, that you can see no way through, no way to endure, no way to get to reigning in this situation is beyond hope. God says, when you're faithless, that's okay. Guess what? He remains faithful. Why? He can't disown himself. So to my sons, I say that day when you feel like nothing can be overcome, something can't be overcome, it's so hard, so deep, so long, so many people hurt, so many different situations going on. God says this to you, I am faithful. So you ain't got nothing to worry about. I remain faithful no matter what you believe. Woo! That gets you fired up. So no matter how low I can get, God says, I'm still faithful. I'm still going to have my purpose accomplished. I'm still going to bring it to completion. Philippians 1:6. Don't you worry about that. Now, if we really took that to heart, boy, we could sit back and relax. It's fun being a Christian again. But when we start thinking, and this comes from the dark side, that your God is too small to deal with anything, you're worshiping the wrong God. You're worshiping the wrong God. God says he's able to do it. Now, here's the thing that's even deeper to me. If you go there, I'll go to my favorite scripture. This is my second favorite scripture. But we have a family crest. And my sons know about it because it hangs in our house above the fireplace. And our family crest was created by another disciple who's a great artist, obviously. And I said, I want a crest for our family so that it goes before us as we go before the Lord. So what we did is came up with my wife and I, we started thinking, what do we want our family to represent? And if you've been with me this weekend, one of the things I love to do, I love to study the Bible. Because it's where we get to see God do his modern day miracles. Where else can I go watch God take somebody from darkness to light? It's not us, it's God. And we get to sit there and use God's word. Let's just be a part of it. And we get to watch God do what he do. That's fun. I don't care what nobody. And so I said, okay, we got to have the sword. Now, our responsibility is to learn how to sling that baby. Not only in other people's lives, but especially and more importantly in our own. You know, do you know how to sling that sword on yourself? When you got the bad attitude in the car, the kids getting on your nerves, do you know how to pull out that word and say, whoo, don't need to be like that, Wendell. You know, that's not good. The wife comes to you and says, we need to pay the bills. Are you kidding me? I'd rather be shot in the leg twice than to sit down and go through the painstaking thing of pain for air that I breathe. That should be free. Electricity, I mean, really, I'm paying for this? Water? I have to pay for water? And be happy about it? No, I don't want to sit down with you and do that now, not tomorrow, not the next day, no time. But I got to pull out that sword. Be considerate as you live with your wife, bro. Yeah. She needs this. That's how she feels secure. Because you're taking care of her. How do you feel about that, bro? I gotta get some on that because the heart gets roughed up on that one. But you know, man, you gotta learn how to swirl that sword. Do you know how to do it on yourself as well as others? We get good at doing it on other people, boy. We sweet. We nice. We can walk up on somebody, oh, I got 12 scriptures for you, and I'm gonna dice you up. Yeah. When I leave, you're gonna be bleeding, hurting, and angry. All the things that God wants you to be. But man, when we learn how to use that puppy on ourselves, it changes things. I have to remember, I'm a sheep. I'm a follower. Man, I'm a follower. This is who I really am. I am not some great, awesome, powerful, disciple leader that people want to feel like you are sometimes. we get puffed up easy. We give us a couple of scriptures and we think we are the bomb. We think we know what we're doing. Well, you got the teens now. Oh, okay, I got that. This is what we're going to do. Really? You got any kids? No. Are you married? No. Have you ever been in the children's ministry to serve? No. But I got this. You know, that's how we are sometimes. We're arrogant beyond belief. I got to remember, we're sheep. But here's the awesome part. I'm following the lion. Amen. The lion of the king of Judah. I don't have to be bad. Because I got the lion out in front. Then he says, man, you got a sword. So that's why we came and I said, okay. So that's the vision. You're a sheep, son. You got to know that God is leading you. And your God is a lion. Love the star in his hand. Yeah. He's looking above to heaven. Yeah. Not thinking about what's going on right here. He's a lion looking above. This world, temporary. Where we're going is awesome. This sword is going to get you there. So what scripture proves that? Let's go to my favorite scripture in God's Bible. And that's Ephesians chapter 3. Are you with me?
Yes.
Okay. Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 20. Hopefully our electronic devices are with us. Yes. Now, God is powerful. We saw that he's faithful. Now we got to see how powerful God is. I love this scripture. And that's the scripture that's at the bottom of our crest. And here's how it starts off. Now to him. Drop the mic. That's it. Now to him. Do you know who him is? That's the point. When you know who him is, it doesn't even matter what the rest of it says. Have you seen today what Dwayne did? Did you see that? You know what God says? Dwayne. That's my glory. Matter of fact, you say something else, we're going to have a problem. That's how God feels about you. Do you really believe that? Now, how long does this last? This is just for a couple seconds? Wow. And then Christ Jesus throughout what? All generations forever and ever. Amen. The church said,
amen.
Come on, brother.
Forever, man. Forever. Forever. Do we think about forever? God, Jesus, they're reigning forever. And guess what? He wants us to reign with him forever. Man, we need to live in forever. We need to think through forever what that means. So I talked to my sons, leaving this to them, man, forever, not for the now, not for what you see. God is bigger than our problems. Even when we're walking aimlessly, God is bigger than all our problems. One question for you. Do you really believe that? If you don't, you need to. If you don't, you're going to be miserable. Yeah. Satan wants you to be miserable, boy. Yeah. That's all he wants. He wants you to be miserable because of your sin. He wants you to be miserable because of Dave's sin. Oh, I'm sorry, Dave. He wants you to be miserable because of Wendell's sin. He wants you to be miserable, period. Yeah. Just wants you to be miserable. Satan sees you getting french fries, and he's like, you got one more than me. Give me that french fry. We all did that as kids. Oh, mom, I can't believe it. Your parents would look at you like, what in the world's wrong with you? Now as you have kids, you get it.
Yes. Yes.
Are you kidding? miss a lot. We don't get it. Let's go to Luke. Y'all still with me?
Yes.
Do I have any more time, or have I ran out of time? Because nobody gave me a time when I was supposed to. When am I supposed to be done? Does anybody know? 12 minutes ago? Okay. Anyway, let's go to Luke chapter 15, verse 1. God, again, I love the scripture where God describes himself, because we do a horrible job describing God. So God got to come in and describe who he is to us. Verse 3, we read through this whole little piece here, then we'll go back and talk about it. Then Jesus told him this parable. Suppose one of you had 100 sheep and loses one of them. Doesn't he leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And when he finds it, he joyfully puts it on his shoulders and goes home. Then he calls his friends and neighbors together and says, rejoice with me, I have found my lost sheep. I tell you, in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner that repents and then over 99 righteous persons who do not need to repent. Or suppose a woman has 10 silver coins and loses one. Doesn't she light a lamp, sweep the house, search carefully until she finds it? And when she finds it, she calls her friends and neighbors together and says, rejoice with me, I have found my lost coin. In the same way, I tell you, there is rejoicing in the presence of angels of God over one sinner who repents. There was a man who had two sons. La, la, la. Not talking about me, though. But the younger one said to his father, Father, I give you my share. Give me my share of the estate. So he divided the property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country where he squandered his wealth in wild living. After he spent everything, there was a severe famine in the whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to the fields to feed the pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have food to spare, and I'm here starving to death! Exclamation point. I will set out, go back to my father, and said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. Ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and he kissed him. The son said to him, I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. I've sinned against heaven and against you. But the father said to his servants, quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger, sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf, kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine who was dead is alive again. He was lost and he's found. So they begin to celebrate. Can't read that without getting emotional, because I see that in the way I've treated God in my own life. Argued with God. God, give me this. Give me that. I want this. I want that. And marched off, squandered it all away as a disciple. Yeah. And you come back and you think, God, I'm no longer worthy. I never was. But now I realize I am worthy to be your son. Ask yourself a question. Have I ever really realized that I'm not worthy to be a Christian? See, we got it all backwards. We think we sought God out. Well, I'm going to go find God. No, that's not what happened. You got lost. And then God said, thanks, bro. That's all we need now is a snot rag. No, thanks, man. But we think we went out looking for God. We look at those stories. God said, I'm going to tell you a story. Let me show you what's really up. You were lost. And I looked for you. I left the 99 that I'd already found. And I went searching for you. Man, where are you? When I found you, I didn't go off on you. I lost a coin. I searched. God was very specific in the words he used. I searched for you. I left. I did something to get you to be here. I just didn't sit back and be God and it all just happened. I came after you, my lost son. This is the one that gets me the most. We come face to face with God with our issues sometimes. We fight with God. Give me my inheritance. Oh, my goodness. I'm not even dead yet. You want, what you gonna get? That's how we are. Give it to me now. And then he didn't even have the decency to stay around his dad and spend it up. Didn't ask him anything. He went a long way off, creating all kinds of anxiety and worry for any parent. When your parent goes, when your kid goes somewhere, they on your mind. You just can't help it. I can't even go see you. You went to a foreign country and squandered everything I worked hard for. Now, here you are coming back home. Woo! We coming to meet them. We jumping off the porch and running down, but we got something else to say. Where is all that money? What'd you do with it? Why are you dressed like this right now? What's going on? What did you? Question after question after rebuke, God wasn't having none of that. Before I could even get it out, God says, quick. Now, you got to understand this. God knew there was an opportunity to probably teach this son a lesson and go over some things with him, but that wasn't the time. That's not what the son needed. Son was afraid. Will my dad even take me back? Man, God said, guess what? We gonna party and have a feast. The part about God that sometimes we forget is God wants to rejoice and party. Come on, brother. Come on. That's our God. Why? He doesn't have no worries. There's nothing bothering him. He is faithful, he's powerful, and he loves us. He got no worries. All he wants to do is have fun and rejoice and, man, party with us. Each situation where he found something, that's God's response. He brought all his friends. Hey, man, here we go. Let's have, is that how you view Christianity? Wow, come on, brother. Do I view Christianity like that? Or do I view it as a lot of rules, things I can't do, stuff I'll never be? I'll never be completely patient, humble, and gentle like the scripture says. But if I work on that, and that's all I'm doing, is I'm trying to be those things, it's never going to happen. Because I don't have it within me. It's in the Holy Spirit. I got to depend on God. So if I sit back and go, God, make me completely humble, gentle, and all the other things I can't be, then it's off my shoulders. You got to ask, how humble am I before my God? But as we see God's character, we see that God is a faithful, powerful, loving God. Amen. He wants to rejoice and party. And I'm going to leave you with a little story that is really interesting to me about my two sons. It's both happened to them at the age of 3, this situation. It also happened around the pool. And one of the things that happened is my oldest son, Kazi, we were swimming that day. We had a ball swimming in the pool and everything. And I got out of the pool, and I was speaking with someone on the side of the pool. We were standing by the deep end of the water. It was about 10 foot. And I was talking to this individual, and then all of a sudden I heard this. Ka-poosh! Looked down to my side. No son. He had dove into the 10-foot water. And I was like, obviously, in that particular part of the conversation, excuse me for a second, and I dove in to save my son. The thing I remember the most about it is when I dove in and it was under the water, and I grabbed him, he was doing like this. He was fired up. He was cheesing. He had a ball. Because in his mind, even though he knew he couldn't swim, he knew his daddy was going to jump in and save him. When I was there looking at him like, you know, he's cheesing. And it made me smile. I'm like, really, man? That's how you going to do me? But when I got it from his perspective, nothing is going to keep my father, not that conversation, not me diving in, nothing's going to keep him from saving me. Man, there's certain things in our life that we avoid, that we just need to jump in with both feet and know God's going to save us. Man, I don't want to jump in, but I need to. I know God's calling me to. I'm jumping because God's going to save me. And I can just imagine how that makes God feel when you're like that with that kind of faith. Makes God smile. The second situation was with my younger son. Same thing, the pool. For some reason, the pool teaches our family a lot of lessons. So my wife and I take my youngest son out to swim, and we're swimming and everything. And then he, he's got all these floating devices on him, the little plastic. You know, he looks like a bumblebee because he's got all this stuff on him. And he's in the pool hanging on to me like this. He's 3 years old. You know, not letting me go. Got his legs wrapped around as much as me as he can. And we're like, the wife and I are like, let go, let go, let go. He's like, I don't think so. You know, I'm holding on. And so then I said something to him. I said, son, do you trust daddy? He said, then let go. He let go immediately. Convicted me to death. Because all I had to say to him, do you trust daddy? He's in his actions, he just immediately let me go. So I trust you. So if you tell me to let you go, I'm letting go. Some of us need to jump in. Some of us need to let go. Do we let go just like that when God says let go? Okay, Andrea. Let go. Toronto's losing. Let it go. Just the way it is. Let go. I had to do that too, so I'm feeling it. It's not, say nothing personal. It beat us too, but you know, hey, Wendell, let it go. Man, there's some things, boy. Come on now, you know. We holding on to like this as we go under the water drowning. We still holding on. I'd rather drown than let go. You know, man, that convicted me, because now every time I feel God telling me I need to do something, I go back to this story and say, Wendell, are you willing to jump in? Wendell, are you willing to let go? We all got to answer these questions to God, to ourselves. You know, God's proven to us, if we've been in this world at all, I don't care if you're a disciple, Christian, or not Christian. God's proven to you that he's faithful, that he's powerful. He says just looking at nature should show you that. And we've had a beautiful 2 days. You can't see the tulips blooming and believe that God is who he says he is after he said he created that. Then there's nothing anybody can do for you except God. God can still do something for you, even if you don't believe, because he's faithful even when we're faithless. You know, as we close out today, just want you to know, the Lord is compassion.